Hello everyone. So let's get started with the next session on underground cables. So in the previous sessions, we had discussed concept of corona, critical disruptive voltage, visual disruptive voltage, corona power loss, and some of the problems pertaining to critical disruptive voltage, visual voltage, and also on corona power loss. And we also discussed how various factors would affect the corona phenomenon of corona and the corona discharge. So this was the first half of module 4. So let's get started with the second half of module 4, that is underground cables. So the learning objectives of this particular session are to understand why are UG cables used, the necessity of UG cables, and to study various types of insulating materials that are used in manufacturing or in constructing a UG cable, and also some of the properties of insulating materials that are used to construct underground cables, and to also understand the construction of UG cable along with the various types of UG cables. Okay. So let's get started with the. So these are the cables or conductors that are usually preferred to transmit power where overhead transmission is not possible. Okay. So the name itself tells you that it is UG underground cables. They are led underground. Okay. They are led underneath the soil. Inside the soil, the buried deep. Okay, so they are mostly preferred in urban areas, industries, and to supply power, usually from overhead to consumer premises. And there you can find wide varieties of materials that are used in order to transmit power in based on the its capacity of carrying particular voltages. So again, you can classify various types of insulators based on its capacity. Okay. And UG cables are expensive when compared to overhead transmission because there are a lot of process manpower that is involved in laying a cable underground when compared to overhead transmission. So maintenance will be a bit higher. Investment will also be capital involved in laying the cables underground will also be high when compared to overhead transmission. So why do you say that UG cables are good or preferred when you say that they are good when compared to overhead transmission? Why are they usually preferred? Because it's reliable. Okay. They say it's less maintenance. Installing cost, investment capital in the beginning, investment capital for manpower in the beginning will be higher. But as and when things proceed further, they may not require much of manual intervention. As a result, you can say that they require less maintenance when compared to overhead transmission. They are durable, and again, it depends. You cannot generalize it. It depends upon the materials that are used. Good appearance in the sense wires, cables will not be visible. They are led underground. There are no chances of electrocution as in case of overhead conductors. The problems in overhead conductors is you might have a tree, a branch of a tree. Sometimes might come in contact with overhead conductors. So it will be prone much more to electrocution or for electrical shock. So such problems will be very less in case of UG cables or underground cables. So what are the necessary factors that one should consider in order to select a particular cable? Okay. We should prefer cables that are usually coated with tin. Why should a cable be coated with tin? Because tinning increases the strength and durability of the cable. So as I said, it will be more reliable. Okay. And in order to increase the current carrying capacity and flexibility, you are supposed to use a stranded copper or aluminum. That means stranded cables are usually preferred because a solid conductor and a stranded conductor, as explained in our previous sessions, you will get to know the major difference between stranded and solid. Solid cannot be made flexible. Okay. So, and the chances of breaking will be very high in case of solid conductors. So if you use a stranded QG cable, one advantage is you can increase its ampacity or current carrying capacity, and also it can be made more flexible because you are using stranded conductors, like either it would be a copper or aluminium. So conductor size again depends upon the application and how much our intention is to carry, how much should a wire carry a load current. Keeping that in mind, conductor capacity size has to be selected. And if you don't do so, what will happen? Current increases beyond the limit. Whenever you say that the current increases beyond the limit, it will cause overheating and voltage drop. There will be so many other problems, insulation breakdown, so many other problems. So selection of conductor size is very much important, because you should know how much would be the value of current based on the loads. You are supposed to decide the conductor size. And again, very much important, you're supposed to see that the conductors are properly insulated, because insulation will ensure safety and reliability. Heating, overheating, all that you can somehow prevent if you use the better materials for the sake of insulation. And you should also ensure proper mechanical protection, because you can prevent manual intervention, the repair intervention, the mechanic cost, maintenance cost, all that can be prevented if you ensure that the cables are mechanically protected. Because when you say that the cables are mechanically protected, the damage that usually happens to the cable can also be prevented. So let's move on to some of the insulating materials that are normally used in designing or in constructing an underground cable, along with its properties. Okay, so an insulating material should possess a good resistivity and dielectric strength, because it is supposed to carry a good amount of current. Its value of thermal coefficient and permittivity must be low. Non-combustible, it should not catch fire. Chemically stable, that in the sense it should not react, because you are laying it underground, it should not react with the materials that are present underground. And it should not be corrosive, it should not get corrosion, it should be corrosion free, moisture free, hygroscopic, so many other parameters, that it should not react with water or moisture related materials or any other thing. Okay, so it should be chemically stable. Good mechanical strength, it should not be easily breakable, it should be flexible. Greater viscosity, tensile strength and plasticity, because that shows the cable is mechanically very much strong and it will also can carry enough amount of current. So these are some of the properties that the insulating material should possess. First, insulating materials, let's get started with the first one. The first one is rubber. So you all know how rubber is obtained. It's obtained from a milky sap of tropical trees or from any other oil products. The relative permittivity, as I already mentioned, is an important property. It should be as less as possible, as low as possible. So over here, rubber has a permittivity that lies between a value of 2 and 3. And dielectric strength is also an important parameter that decides the strength, mechanical strength of the cable. So it's having a dielectric strength of around 30 kV per meter. And resistivity is an important parameter of any insulating material, whereas a rubber has a resistivity of 10 to 18 ohm centimeter. So that itself will tell that it's most feasible and ready for insulation. So the major drawback, as I said, you also mentioned that one important property is it should be chemically stable. But when you say that the property of rubber is it can absorb moisture and its maximum safe temperature is low, around 38. When you say that it absorbs moisture, then you say that it is not chemically stable. You are violating one of the property of insulating material. Okay. But yet it was used conventionally in the beginning, but later on people are moving on to. This doesn't mean that they are using rubber now. Earlier, it was rubber, paper, so many other components. Based on the drawback, new materials started arising or flourishing, and that is used now. Okay, rubber is soft and it is prone to damage. It's not chemically stable because it absorbs moisture and it's prone to damage when you expose it to sunlight. Okay, and one more thing is you cannot use a pure rubber for insulation. Pure rubber cannot be used for insulation. Then what should be used? When you say that pure rubber cannot be used for insulation, what can be used? So you have studied in chemistry way back in your PU or in your high school that vulcanization is an important parameter that adds efficacy to the performance of a rubber. Its efficacy would be better, its capacity would be better. So let us move on to the next rubber, because initially they used this rubber for the sake of insulation, but it's had a lot of disadvantages. So they stopped using it, and the next important form of insulating material, form of rubber, is vulcanized Indian rubber. It's not a pure rubber. We previously discussed about the properties of a pure rubber. Later on, that had drawbacks. We will move on to the next one, that is vulcanization. Vulcanized Indian rubber. As I already mentioned, pure rubber must undergo vulcanization. If your intention is to use it as an insulating material, it has to undergo vulcanization. Okay, so it's a chemical reaction. You're mixing up your rubber with certain materials like zinc oxide, red lead, and traces of sulfur. Okay, when you add this to a pure rubber, it gets vulcanized. So what are the advantages of vulcanization? It'll be more durable, it'll have a better mechanical strength when compared to a natural rubber. The main disadvantage, vulcanized Indian rubber will also have a disadvantage that over here it reacts with sulfur. Okay, it reacts, that is one of the disadvantages. So what was an alternate for that? A tinned copper rubber was used in order to prevent the vulcanized rubber, because it used to react, sulfur reacts with copper. As a result, it was tinned copper conductor was used in order to prevent this particular reaction. And where as VIR cables, they later termed it as VIR cables. That means it is protected with or provided with vulcanized Indian rubber insulation. So this was normally used for low and medium voltage cables. This particular rubber was normally used for low and medium voltage cables. It's more durable when you compare it with impregnated. It's more durable when you compare it with impregnated paper cables, because whenever you hear the word paper itself, it will have certain drawbacks. So it's more durable, it's reliable more when compared to the next insulating material that we will just see is nothing but impregnated paper. What is this impregnated paper? You have a paper here. So whenever you hear the word paper, you get to know it absorbs moisture. That is itself is one of the disadvantage. Well, let's see what is this impregnated paper. So you are here, the chemically pulp paper, usually it's made up of wood drippings, and impregnated paper is with paraffinic and naphthenic material. So why it is called as impregnated? Because you're using two materials like paraffinic and naphthenic material. As a result, it is called as a impregnated paper. So this was a total replacement for rubber insulation. This was a total replacement for rubber insulation. So why usually people prefer impregnated paper is it's economical, and it has a low value of capacitance with high dielectric strength and high insulation resistance. Because these two are some of the important properties of an insulating material, and impregnated paper is providing it. As a result, people usually prefer impregnated paper when compared to a vulcanized rubber insulation. Main thing is it is hygroscopic. Whenever you have the paper, it absorbs moisture. Okay, and when it absorbs moisture, earlier we said it had better insulation resistance. Once it absorbs moisture, insulation resistance will drop. Okay, so because of this, to prevent this problem, they are never left unsealed. They are protected with some covering. Okay, some covering is protected because you can absorb moisture. The next one is varnished cambric. Okay, what is this varnished cambric? Okay, you have a cotton cloth over here that has been impregnated with varnish. Just imagine, just take a cloth, paint it with, coat it with some paint, a varnish. You can imagine that is how a varnished cambric look like. Okay, so this cambric is covered on a conductor forming a tape, and its surfaces are tinned with petroleum jelly to avoid sliding of one turn over the other as and when the cable is bent. And again, cloth is also, they're telling that you're supposed to take a cotton cloth. Cotton cloth is again hygroscopic. Okay. So dielectric strength is around 4 kV per millimeter, and its permittivity lies in the range of 2.3 to 3.8. And this varnish cambric is also called as empire tape, one of the important insulating material in UG cable. PVC, most of you all would have heard about PVC. So it's polymerization of acetylene, and it's a form of powder. It's an organic compound. It's in the form of powder. So over here, this material, when you're supposed to use it as an insulator, it is mixed with materials like plasticizer, which are liquids with high boiling points. Plasticizer, they're nothing but liquids. They have high boiling points. And they also have high insulation resistance and dielectric strength. They are capable to provide mechanical toughness over a wide range of temperature. Okay, this is a major advantage. Insulation resistance will be very high. Dielectric strength is also high, very high. Capable of providing good mechanical strength for wide ranges of temperature. Elasticity is very poor, that of rubber. It's not that elastic. And again, they are used for low, medium, domestic and power insulation. You might have seen PVC based cables. Next one is cross-linked polyethylene. These are usually preferred for high temperatures. Ethylene propylene rubber, again for high temperatures. Okay, that was for medium and low voltage. Whatever we discuss now, insulating materials for medium and low voltages. So this is a thermosetting plastic, and have a different polyethylene chains linked together. Why you have different polyethylene chains, you would have studied in chemistry. Because our intention is these XLPE cables should work on high temperature applications. As a result, when the bonding is very high, when the chains are linked together, its capacity will be very high, and as a result, they can withstand high temperatures. They have high dielectric losses when compared to polyethylene based insulating material, but again, better etching care. They are more reliable and they are resistant to moisture. The next one is ethylene propylene rubber. Again, a thermosetting plastic will have a different polyethylene chains, and it's a copolymer of ethylene and propylene. These are normally called as elastomers. Again, these two are usually preferred for high temperature applications. This is more flexible when compared to polyethylene and XLPE. And there, the dielectric, more direct losses were very high in XLPE when compared to polyethylene. Here also, you have greater dielectric losses than the both. Both in the sense, it's XLPE and PE. What is PE? It's polyolefins. It's a polymer that comes under polyolefins. Polyethylene has lower dielectric losses when compared to PVC. And the problem over here is it is sensitive to moisture under voltage stress. Again, all these three are usually XLPE, elastomer and PE, polyethylene are usually preferred for high voltages. Let's see the constructional feature of a cable. This is a construction of, this is how an underground cable looks like. It has a conductor, lead sheet, armoring, paper insulation, bedding, and serving. Let us see each and every parts in detail. First one is core, that has to be strong because it has to withstand the remaining part of strands of the conductor. Cables usually have one or more core, and again it depends upon the application, whether it's high voltage, low voltage or medium voltage. Stranded cables are usually preferred. Stranded copper or aluminium is used because you have to make cable more flexible. It should not break easily. It should not be brittle. As a result, stranded materials are used. Copper is usually preferred because it is denser and heavy, and it is more conductive when compared to aluminium. Okay. Electrical equivalent of aluminium conductors says that it have a cross-sectional area approximately 1.6 times larger than copper, but half of the weight, that which usually saves on a material cost. Both has certain advantages and disadvantages, whereas copper is preferred because it's denser, heavy. The aluminium is light when compared to copper, but it's more conductive than aluminium. And again, cost, there are so many other parameters that affect. Based on that, manufacturer can consider whether it's a copper or aluminium. Again, depends upon the requirements. Conductors over here are usually subjected to annealing. What is this annealing? Heating and cooling of conductor material. Why should these conductors should be subjected to annealing? Why you should heat and cool them? Because you should make them more malleable and less brittle. Why malleable? Like, you have to give its own shapes. You should tap on them, tap on the conductor material. You should start tapping on them, and you should, when you tap, it should take its own shapes. But when you don't subject them to annealing, they might break. And you should, it has to be less brittle, very less brittle. Because when you hit it, if it starts breaking, you cannot make the conductor malleable. It cannot take its own shape. As a result, they are subjected to annealing. And you have to coat them up because they should not be prone to any other chemical reactions. Okay, it can either be surface coating is usually done with tin, nickel, silver, lead, alloys of copper conductors. Why is it usually done? Why is this coating is done? To prevent them from insulation and also preventing the deterioration of the copper material at high temperature. It should not lose its property at high temperature. As a result, coating is usually preferred. I already mentioned it can either be solid or stranded. Both have their own advantages and disadvantages. Solid is of lower cost, and it can easily form its desired shape. And solids are usually preferred at certain permanent installations. Stranded have their own advantages because they are more flexible and you can prefer them for higher ratings. Insulation, we have discussed wide varieties of insulating materials. Normally used insulating materials are rubber, impregnated paper, varnished cambric, which is also called as empire tape. So these are normally used insulating materials, and we have discussed these properties previously. Next comes metallic sheet or lead sheet. Why is this sheet provided? It's used to protect the cable from moisture or any other gases or any liquid. Again, metallic sheet of copper tape, lead, aluminium is wrapped over the ring. Again, this has to be wrapped with certain materials, and it provides a path for fault or leakage currents. When you wrap it, the sheet will provide a path for fault or leakage currents. It will not propagate onto the other sides. And sheets are usually earthed at one end of the cable. Bedding, and this is a process that is used to prevent the sheet from corrosion. And how are you protecting it, sheet from corrosion? You're using a fibrous material or jute or Hessian tape is wrapped on it to prevent the. What is this armoring? Using again two or more layers of steel wire or steel tape to protect the cable from mechanical injury. That means you are providing more and more protection. You're using insulating materials in bedding, and you're also using fibrous material. Armoring, you are again using a steel wire to enhance its mechanical strength so that you can prevent the cable from mechanical injury. Tinning and galvanizing is usually done to prevent it from rust. Because you are keeping it underground, you should ensure that it won't corrode or it not rust. Normally used materials are phosphor bronze, phosphor bronze, or tinned copper braid is normally used because steel has iron. Whenever you see that, it is prone to corrosion. So when you tin it or galvanize it, you can prevent it from rust. Serving. Again, over here, you have using a fibrous material, a jute or any other material, to protect armoring from atmospheric condition. Every phase or every stage, you will be using different materials to protect it from rust or any other, or to either rust or to enhance its mechanical strength. Let's move on to the next, that is various types of cables. We will just look into this. Cables are classified based on the insulation and operating voltage. Usually, they are classified based on the operating voltages. So they are divided into different groups. Low tension cables, if it is up to 1000 volts. High tension cables, if it is up to 11 kV. Super tension cables, if the voltage operating voltage range is between 22 kV to 30 kV. Extra tension cables, again, if the operating voltage range is between 33 kV to 66 kV. Extra super voltage cables, if it is above 132 kV. This is how cables are classified based on their operating voltages as low tension, high tension, super tension, extra tension, and extra super voltage cables. Again, they saw the different ranges, voltage ranges. They have to be robust in order to withstand such high voltages. So you can either find a single core cable, double core cable, three or four core cables. For a three-phase system, usually three core cables or three single core cables are usually preferred, again, depending upon the operating voltage and load. Let's start with a low tension cable. Name itself will tell for operating voltages, for a less operating voltage. So this is how a low tension cable construction looks like. So for voltage up to 1000 volts or 1 kV, low tension cables are preferred. And here you need not bother much about electrostatic stress and their thermal conductivity. Okay. And they don't require much changes in their constructional facility. You don't expect much changes in their constructional features because even though you say that voltage is 1 kV, you can use them up to 6 kV. And we have discussed about a lot of insulating materials. Normally used insulating materials in case of a low tension cable is an impregnated paper, varnished cambric, or vulcanized rubber. Pure rubbers, as already mentioned, they are not being used. Okay. And again, you can find low tension cables. It can be either single core, double, or even triple core. Tinning is also done, or galvanizing is also done to prevent it from corrosion. As already mentioned, tinning is usually protect the cable from moisture or any other gases. You have also have metallic sheath, metal. You also have same construction to prevent metallic sheath from corrosion. You have to use fibrous material, jute or hessian tape. Armored again to prevent excessive sheath losses. They are very simple in construction and availability of larger copper section. So these are some of the major advantages of low tension cables. Okay, let's move on to the next one, that is underground cables for three phase. Again, you should see their construction has to be robust here. So multi-core construction is usually preferred if the voltages are above 66 kV, as it is economical, multi-core construction. Okay, for voltages beyond 66 kV, single-core cables are usually preferred because three-core cables are more complex, cumbersome. They're more complex, maintenance, mechanical cost pertaining to them would be very high. As a result, for voltages above 66 kV, single-core cables are usually preferred. So you have belted cables. Some of the cables that you can see in three phase are belted cables that operate up to voltages of 1000 volts. Screen cables that operate up to voltages of 22 kV to 66 kV. Pressure cables above 66 kV, as the name itself is telling. So these are some of the cables that are used. So to brief off or sum up today's lecture on underground cables, we started off with the introduction. Why are UG cables usually preferred and the properties of underground cables? And you will need to expect that they has to be reliable. They should have good insulation resistance. And we also see that we also saw some of the important properties of insulating materials, like insulation resistance, mechanical strength, so on and so forth. And also we discussed wide varieties of insulating materials, starting from rubber till cross-linked polyethylene, elastomers. We also discussed the construction of cables. How is each phase, like starting from core to serving, how each phase will contribute for the construction of cable? Why is armoring done? What is the function of lead sheath? How to protect the lead sheath from corrosion? All that was discussed, along with various types of cables that I preferred for single phase and for three phase applications. Some more details on UG cables for three phase, we shall discuss in the next session. Thank you.